Intelligence Agency joins me now from Paris. It's good to see you, sir, as always. The first thing that does occur to me reading that is you have tremendous technological and scientific breakthroughs, but at the same time, the business of space is still deeply enmeshed in geopolitics, be it Russia or China, and the fact you've decided you can't go to the Chinese station.
Yeah. Hi, Richard. Really good to see you again, and always a pleasure to be with you. No, it's true. Geopolitics, unfortunately, has also entered space. Space used to be a bit outside or above geopolitics, literally. But now, as you say, China, the tensions with Russia, of course, all this has changed our life quite significantly. At the day of the invasion of Russia and Ukraine, I had to make, together with my member states, very clear decisions to separate all our cooperations, which we have built up over more than a decade or several decades, actually, with Russia, right, and literally to stop it and to replace Russian technology and Russian elements of a future cooperation with European ones. And this, I can tell you, has not been an easy process.
Do you follow or tend to follow, for example, the way the EU will go in terms of assisting Ukraine if it needed satellite information or there was some aspect of work that the ESA could offer that would assist Ukraine? Is that something you could and or would do?
Yeah, I mean, we are already offering technology to Ukraine. It's probably not widely disseminated. Of course, this is all information that that serves the defense communities. But what we do is normally offering technology that is used in the civilian domain, but also as applications for security reasons or for security domains. An example is agricultural production. For example, we have measured how much less wheat is being produced in Ukraine due to the war and the destruction of some of the fields. Of course, the infrastructure has been widely shown on satellite images, bridges, roads that have been damaged. But also the use of telecommunications is certainly something where satellites are needed. We all know the examples of Starlink, but Europe actually now is also in the process of building up a European broadband network called Iris Square, where we also want to offer in the future, it's not yet existing, but in the future, telecom access through a constellation of satellites. So yes, there's a lot happening. Right. We, of course, yes, go ahead.
What's your big idea? What's the thing that you're working on now that's going to blow the socks off and everybody's going to say, my word, that's good?
Well, if I mention one example that does blow the socks off, that might be to collect solar energy in space through photovoltaics, as we do it on the ground, but through huge infrastructures, literally an infrastructure of satellites that are being put together of the length of 1.72 kilometers and beaming down 2 gigawatts of power to the Earth, and therefore having this power available 24/7. That's something where we are working on a concept. I have to say that this is not yet technology that is proven to work. We have to do some feasibility studies and make sure that technology, but also some other regulatory aspects can be met. But if that works, the whole energy crisis, including the dependency of Europe from other nations, in particular Russia, would actually be something that we could really address. But I have to really put a big question mark or a big caution or a big caveat to it, because this is future work to come, but we are engaging in this domain. And that would literally blow off the socks if that works.
Well, literally, especially if the rays go off a bit and suddenly you get more than a suntan from that coming down on top of your head. I hear talk about a new moon time. For the 2 people who go onto the moon, or the 5 people who get there, why do they need their own time zone? You just change your watch and decide which part of the world you want to follow.
Well, it's a bit like take the situation on Earth. If you want to meet somebody at lunchtime at a certain point, you need a reference time, and this is exactly what we are discussing right now on the moon. You need a reference length, like Greenwich used to be. Now it's the UTC time zone, which is defining time on Earth. And we need the same on the moon. If there are robots, if there are astronauts, if there's infrastructure, of course, you need to calibrate your clocks towards a certain time zone. In fact, what we're doing there, and this is another quite exciting project, is building up a navigation and communication network. We call it Moonlight, which will be satellites around the moon that offer navigation signals like GPS or Galileo here on Earth, and similar things for communication. So yes, this is future projects, future initiatives, but yes, this is about to be built because we have got the first funding slice last November from our member states.